This is one of their mobile kitchens that they actually...
is that even some, what I call habitual...
beautiful Stop and Shop in the Wilton... penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that it... Absolutely. What's the name of the show? Good evening and welcome once again to the Marty Heiser Show. We have an incredible show lined up. I think you're going to find it very entertaining. But I just want to say a word about what happened down in Florida and how it relates to this community in Newtown and Sandy Hook. And I can only imagine that reliving some of what the trauma was that's unfolding down in Florida right now had to bring some incredibly painful and devastating memories to families, as they see on their TV, parents wondering where their kids were, desperately trying to get in touch with them, and then for 17 families, just the absolute heartbreak that families in this area experienced at Sandy Hook. And I just want to say that our hearts go out to you, obviously down in Florida, but almost more intensely in this region, in this area right now. And there has to be some answer to this. I don't know exactly what that is, but I just want you to know that the pain that may be resurfacing as a result of this school shooting that you may be reliving is something that we want to share, we want to walk with you. I go to Walnut Hill Community Church, and there was four families that were directly impacted with the loss of a child from that church. And in addition to that, just a sense of brokenness, of vulnerability, of anger, of frustration. Just want you to know our hearts are with you, and we're going through this together. And there's people, friends, family, faith communities. If you need to talk to someone, just do. But know that you're not walking through this alone. A dear friend of mine, Tony Simon Lombardi, had a birthday just a week ago. And Tony was kind enough to put together this Valentine's for me. So Tony, I know you're out there. I know you're watching the show. And I want to thank you for the Valentine. And I want to thank you for inviting me to your birthday party and what fun that was. And I hope you like the mug that my wife picked out for you. And we miss you very many more happy birthdays. But thank you very much for this Valentine. I will absolutely cherish it. And thanks for watching the show. Okay, tonight we're calling it Two Authors and a Lady with Cats. And I know that doesn't capture all the grandeur of what we're talking about with the cat, the Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary, which we're going to get to at the end. And by the way, if you see this number right here, you too could become a foster parent to a cat tonight. I think we can put this together. Am I right? We can do this? Okay, so for those of you at home, like small children and your parents are gone, dial this number, and by the time they get back from TGI Fridays, they've probably had a few beverages, you can show them the new cat, because Jill and Danielle will come to your house with this cat that you too will adopt tonight. But more on that later. We're going to finish with that. But my first guest is Timothy Askew. Thank you so much for coming in.
Well, thanks for
having
me.
I really appreciate it. And I'm going to put up this book, if we can get a shot of this. The book is called The Poetry of Small Business, An Accidental Entrepreneur's Search for Meaning. I mean, that's quite a mouthful. What prompted you to write this book?
Failure. Lots and lots of failure. I started out to be a minister or a professor, something noble and good, a social worker, something like that. Uh-huh. And I figured out real quickly that I was just trying to figure out my life, and I became an actor. I was assistant dean at a college out in in California, but I became an actor, and I basically failed at that. Although I was on Broadway in a couple of shows, I did a play with Jack Lemmon in a play.
And what was the soap opera that you were on?
Another World.
Another World.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
do you see the residuals for that, like $30 checks?
No, I don't think so. I don't think I get them anymore. But okay. I was only on there for 6 months. But then I was an opera singer. I failed at that. I became a Broadway producer. I failed at that. I lost a ton of money.
It's funny. We have something in common. It's funny because I read your book and I came across some quotes. And just this past week, I sent one of the quotes you said from Winston Churchill.
Which
says the definition of success is going from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. That was one of your titles in one of the chapters of your book.
Right.
And I was thinking that's a little bit what you're describing.
Also, I had some personal issues. I had struggled with addiction particularly when I was an actor, So eventually, I formed this company quite by accident. I was hired by somebody, you know, a very high-level person, a CEO who wanted me to do a very discreet project for him, a sales project. I had no background in sales or anything else, but I started doing it, and I was just great at it. I don't know what makes one a good salesman, but I didn't even talk about what he wanted me to, but it was with very high-level people. I formed a company. I started getting lots and lots of work through this guy, and eventually I formed a company of people who, and it was a company called Corporate Rain, and You know, Wall Street Journal rated us the number one boutique sales outsourcer in the world about 5 years later. So, but we were a very small company, but we did very elite sort of executive sales work.
But when you say you didn't know what made you a good salesman, that's not altogether true, because you did. In your book on page 31, you talk about the need of being a storyteller. And you compare and contrast that with sort of vocational training that you get in schools.
Right.
And with a good old-fashioned liberal arts education. And you're saying that type of broad liberal arts education can actually prepare you for business in that sense. And you talk about, you said, the ability to be creative, poetry, passion, and metaphor together to recruit employees. The storyteller in chief. You say a CEO needs to be the storyteller in chief to be able to kind of set a vision for what they're doing. And you talk about English departments are in decline. Perhaps that is still a future for the liberal arts major as a business leader who can call on the non-quantitative intuitions of history, music, art, philosophy, and faith with a creativity and flexibility rather than just technical expertise. The new entrepreneur will be a person who can tell and retell evolving business stories, synthesizing and communicating new concepts and creations, and adjust quickly and emphatically to the changing international world. That's pretty good stuff.
Oh, well, thank you.
He's a hell of a writer. Hemingway's got nothing on him. But what is your concept with that?
I basically feel that all the STEM stuff is very wrongheaded, and it really goes through business schools, too. I mean, I write about entrepreneurship. Uh-huh. I'm an entrepreneur. Business schools, you know, I think what they need to do is blow them all up. They need to go back and force business people not to study marketing, not to study spreadsheets, just go back and read philosophy and English and music and do all those things for at least 6 months before they even can study business. And the reason is that in the future, things are changing so fast that people who know how to think, people know how to strategize, are going to be rewarded, and even brilliant individual technicians are going to be outmoded so fast that what really is going to reward future business leadership is the liberal arts. I think it's totally wrongheaded the way people, particularly young students right now coming out of college, they want a job right away, and they should think more about becoming who they are and deciding what that is.
Oddly enough, and this may be a bit of a jump, but I think that's how we won World War II. Mm-hmm. Because World War II, the Axis, the Germans, very mm-hmm. Teutonic, very mm-hmm. martial, top down, you'll follow the orders and this is it. But in America, right. the U.S. Marines, they would say, you know, finish the mission, right. adjust. You know, the battle plan, the first shot is fired, the battle plan is thrown out the window. You need to adjust, you need to adapt, and you need to get the mission done. And that was sort of the guiding philosophy of the American or the Allied, you know, military in World War II, and they came up against the Prussians, and if it didn't go right exactly how they didn't know. They knew who's going to give them orders, and they just collapsed en masse. It took a while, but they collapsed en masse. But yeah, that's interesting. I mean, you have kind of almost an esoteric Zen philosophy towards business. I saw you in one of your interviews saying you're not that interested in making money, and you never were. You talked about how you wanted to really just build a business, a sense of community, and there was almost like AA meets Steve Jobs from Apple.
Exactly.
You know, and that this was a way for you to, you know, work on your recovery,
right.
build community, and if you could pay your mortgage and pay for groceries along the way, all the better.
And I also made it a point never to hire anyone who wasn't better than me, too.
Yeah.
So, I think humility is a useful business skill.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Go ahead.
Now, I was just going to say, the business ability to create community, meaning, dignity, independence, and happiness. You talk a lot about what I would say yearning for significance as opposed to just success. And you said all entrepreneurs are a little crazy. That there's a deep search for meaning in life, in itself madness. And you talk a lot about that in your personal journey in starting this business that you were working on recovery from addiction. Was it alcohol, drugs?
Or I'd rather not talk about what it was.
Okay, fair enough. But you were working on recovering.
Right.
And you found that through this entrepreneurial spirit, building this community, building this business,
right.
it was good for you.
Right. I built a community that would make me a better human being. But also I gathered around me people who shared my values. Community is something that's disappearing increasingly every day in this country. And, you know, the church doesn't serve that purpose really anymore. The country doesn't even have an identity. It's become balkanized. As an entrepreneur, you have a chance to create your own private Idaho, in a sense, a unique place where as long as you set the parameters, you can create a community of value through your own, I want to say morality.
Yeah. Yeah, that it sounds like that's what you were able to do. And you talk about hiring people, and you said that the ones that you wanted to hire were the ones that were, like you said, crazy. Like you wanted to hire the ones that it seemed like they were a little off. They marched to the beat
right.
of their own.
You know,
drum.
Jeff Bezos, when he first was hiring for Amazon, his hiring company. You know, he was talking to him. They came to him and said, "Well, who are you looking for?" He says, "Give me your wackos."
Yeah, yeah.
And I agree with that. I think, particularly in an entrepreneurial company, I think you hire people and you don't ride them. You don't try to control them. Mm-hmm. Particularly, I had a sales company. I think salespeople especially, there are all kinds of ways of being a good salesman. But if you have one, you let them do it their own way. You don't try to control them. Hmm. But within the context of a certain value system.
Yeah. Did you ever have to fire anyone in your business?
They usually took care of themselves. I mean, they tended to disappear.
Oh, really?
I think Hillary Clinton,
people that kind of disappearing. I shouldn't get.
No, I had a small company too.
I'm sorry. Forget politics. I'm sure these were all reasonable.
I only had 42 like employees too, and I think you can only do that with a smaller company. I think once you get over 50 employees, then it becomes different. I'm not sure you could. I'm not sure you can continue to do things the way I did them.
Now, the basis of your business was you arranged high-level meetings, the right. proverbial first contact
right.
with high-level decision makers.
Senior VP through C-suite.
Yeah, so companies, like what were some of the companies you did?
I don't know, Harvard, Deloitte & Touche, AIG, Con Edison, AT&T, Wells Fargo, Gallup, Avena, Sophia.
Okay, so you would have a stable of customers that right. had some service that they wanted to offer,
right.
but were having trouble getting that meeting. And you would meet with the executives and say, listen, we have an organization that will right. do wonders for your supply chain or whatever it is,
right.
and they would like to, you know, have a meeting.
Yeah, and our point of view about it was we just was not to sell anything. It's just mm-hmm. mainly to listen to them. And I just hired people who had a rich life experience and could relate to people well. And that's all it was. It was not a genius business. It's just that a lot of people don't take the time to just serve.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I wrote an article a couple of weeks ago called Service is the New Killer App. I mean, mm-hmm. because it's the one thing that you can't co-opt. You cannot co-opt service. You cannot co-opt goodness
yeah.
with a new technology. And that's why technology can't take over everything. And that's one way the entrepreneur can kind of fight back against big boys too. Technologically, it's just
the thing I liked about you talk a little bit or a lot about perseverance and just the stick-to-itiveness. You talk a lot about authenticity. You know, when you said you weren't sure why you were good in sales, I think it had a lot to do with authenticity. And you did a whole chapter, it seemed like, on authenticity and what that meant, how authenticity is compelling. Like the anecdotal story about the judge who, when he's asked to define pornography, says, I can't define it, but I know it when I see it. Buyers feel much the same way. They know authenticity when they see it. Is that something that you can't really develop? You either have it or you don't?
Yes.
Authenticity?
Yes. I mean, you can work on it. But again, it's like I said, you learn those things through the liberal arts, like going back to what we were talking about before. You learn that by exploring yourself. I mean, any number of ways, religion, therapy, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I think those things come before all the techniques of business. They come and if you can set a tone, a trope for your company, it'll through brand your company without any branding at all, because mm-hmm. it'll just be there in the people you hire and in the tone of what you've created. It'll automatically be there. You hire the right people with that, the values you share.
Hmm. I appreciate it. Listen, I tell you, I was reading the book. I read it through in one sitting. I could not put it down. I have a small business myself.
Yep.
I'm a painting contractor, but uh-huh. a lot of this really came through, and I appreciate it. The book is called The Poetry of Small Business, an Accidental Entrepreneur's Search for Meaning. This is a really good book. How can people get in touch with you and get this book?
You can find it on Amazon.
Amazon?
Yeah, The Poetry of Small Business, and it'll be there.
It's very good. I can't recommend it enough, and I thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you,
Mike. I really appreciate it. Appreciate it. Okay, if you live in Ridgefield, Connecticut, you will know my next guest. And you want to know why I know you'll know my next guest? Because he has more friends than I think anyone in the town of Ridgefield. Here's a group shot. I hope we can get a picture of this, of him at the Ridgefield Playhouse. I don't know if we can get a shot of that, but these are just some of Alex Fischetti's friends at Ridgefield Playhouse. There's Allison Stockel right there. There's Alex, and there's the whole group. And then on the next picture, all of a sudden everyone is pointing at Alex. I'm not sure what the story behind that one is, but all of a sudden everyone is pointing at Alex because he's the center of attention. He is a writer. He works at AMC Theater. He went to Ridgefield High School. He lives in Ridgefield, Connecticut, although you're originally from?
Tarrytown, New York.
Tarrytown, New York. And you've written this wonderful book called The Lonesome Boy and the Blonde-Haired Angel. And how did you, first of all, thank you for coming in.
Thank you for having me on, Marty. Appreciate
it. Really appreciate it. What was the thinking behind this book? And what made you decide to write this book?
Well, basically, I wrote this book as a tribute to a very special person in my life, because for the longest time, I have autism. I have Asperger's, a form of autism, and I was socially isolated for the longest time, and then I came across this very beautiful person who came into my life and just changed my life in beautiful ways, socially and as a person and in general, and made me open up my heart and mind to the goodness in people, and that's what led me to be the social butterfly that so many know today.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I mean, you talk about being isolated and so forth. You're like the most popular guy. People just gravitate towards you and they love you. But now let me, I don't want to be a story wrecker or anything like that, but basically you lived in Tarrytown and then moved to Florida, lived in Ridgefield and then moved to Florida.
Yeah, I lived in Tarrytown. I lived in Tarrytown for 13 years, and then I lived in Ridgefield. I first moved to Ridgefield in 2004. And then I moved to Vero Beach in 2009.
Okay, so then that, so you were in Ridgefield, you moved down to Vero Beach.
Yes.
And even now there, because some of your situations, you found it even more difficult to reach out.
It was.
Even Ridgefield's kind of a close-knit community. But I can imagine being the new kid on the block in Vero Beach, you were heartbroken.
It was, you know, because I'd spend like, 18 years on the East Coast, and then I go down to the Sunshine State, and I have to say, it's interesting having a green Christmas from 2009 to, so that was very interesting, but you learn to adjust to your settings, and I was, I'm just thankful to be able to live anywhere, just a blessing in and of itself, and I actually made a trip back down to Vero not too long ago to pay a visit, and so it's, I'm grateful for my experiences down there, absolutely.
All right, now, my crack team here at the Marty Heiser Show, through great expenditures of effort, have come up with Rennie, right? Is that how I'm pronouncing it?
Rennie,
okay. And I think if this all works out, let's see if we can get Rennie on the phone. And she just wants to share her story a little bit about how she met. And have you talked to her in a while?
It's been a little while, because she works as a school teacher, and she's...
Okay. Rennie, this is Marty Heiser. You're on the Marty Heiser Show, and I'm here with your good friend Alex. You can say hi.
Hi, Alex. How are you?
Good, Rennie. How are you?
Well, as you're talking, the vast viewing audience is seeing the picture of you. And by the way, you're referred to as the blonde-haired angel. I would say that's pretty accurate.
I am. Who would have thought it?
Now, have you seen it? Have you gotten this book with the illustration and everything on it?
Of course I have.
So have you seen ones where you have the wings, like angel wings behind you? Did you pick up on that?
I did. People that know me find that hard to believe, though.
Well, tell me a little bit. Alex was saying how he went down to Vero Beach, didn't really know anyone, and he was just sharing how this lady, who we now have on the phone, had a really profound effect. What was your memory of first meeting Alex?
Well, I believe I remember seeing Alex and his family at church and never really spoke to him. And then I was at the mall one day and saw him from afar and saw him by himself. And I thought, I'm going to go introduce myself and just say hi. And so that kind of started this friendship with us, just for the fact to just go over and say hi to him.
Wow. So, Alex, what did you think when Rennie showed an interest in you and you saw her in the mall and at the library?
Yeah, I was working at the AMC theaters, which is connected to the mall, and I just and I saw her, and you know like how you like see people and you're just like drawn to them, like I had seen her in church, as she said, and I just felt the need just to walk up and say hi to her, and before we knew it, we were starting having a conversation about movies and life and family and so on, and it just beautifully snowballed from there.
Wow. Well, Rennie, I mean, I can't help but notice, because every chapter has a Bible verse at the beginning of it. And what was some of your timely advice, maybe something out of the scriptures that you shared with Alex that had such a profound effect on him?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, first, I feel like the Lord compelled me to go over and talk to Alex. And, you know, that's how much God loves each one of us. And, you know, I wanted to meet Alex where he was at. I had no expectations of him and just loved him where he was at and for who he was. And, you know, I think just, you know, just talking and just trying to encourage him and to let him know that, you know, God created him and that he's awesome and that he needs to see in himself what we see in him. And I think it just kind of started from there.
Wow. Wow.
Really helped me out a great deal. Really just helped me in my faith, and it just opened so many beautiful doors open for me.
Wow. Well, they say Christianity is a team sport. It's we're not supposed to go through this life together, and I think it's just really beautiful the way you came alongside Alex at a time when he was really kind of down and out. Would that be fair?
Well, just socially isolated, just didn't know anybody, and now it's now I've come to a stage in my life where I know basically everybody.
I know, and everyone knows you too. Well, Renee, thank you so much for coming on. And
absolutely, and Alex, I am so proud of you, and just so honored to know you. And the sky's the limit for you, and I am just so happy. Could not be happier or more proud of you.
You're the best, Renee. I love you.
Okay, right. Love you too, Alex, and thank you so much for having me on.
Sure, thank you. Thanks for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Okay.
Wow.
Thank you for doing that. That was amazing.
Well, I just, you know, I think outside the box here, you know, so, you know, we tried to do that.
That's great.
Wasn't that kind of fun?
That was fabulous.
I didn't know where to get the phone number. I was like, okay, blonde-haired angel. I Googled it. You should see what comes up. It's unbelievable. No, I'm kidding. I didn't do that. That was a joke.
No,
but that's great. I mean, what a great story, really.
It just takes one person, you know, just to open. I mean, it's just to open yourself up to what's good, and, you know, just to really like have the courage just to like branch out and see what's good in people. And it just took a very special person like her just for me just to become who I am. It's to think that for so many years I hardly knew just anybody, and now I'm being invited to parties, I'm being invited to fundraisers, I'm on so many gala committees. It's just remarkable how my life's just taken such a huge, beautiful 360 since I've known her.
Wow, well that's fantastic. You know, it's interesting because it's you know, the whole issue, like my daughter, my oldest daughter, has a little attention deficit, you know, ADD attention deficit, and she would have some of the similar situations where she didn't maybe feel as comfortable in social settings, you know, found it difficult to meet new people and would really rather just, you know, kind of be by herself and isolated. And there was a friend of hers in grade school, actually, in Ridgefield High School, named CJ. And CJ was her one friend, and she reached out to her, and it made all the difference in the world. And now she's married. She's a flight attendant, of all things, so she's always around people. But same kind of thing. I mean, I think sometimes when you meet someone and they're maybe a little different or maybe not, you know, the most outgoing guy in the room, sometimes those are the real gems.
It really is. I mean, it took me a while for me to discover, you know, for the spark just to like be out there. I work at the Ridgefield Playhouse, where now I meet people. I've met so many friends there, and I don't think I can ever like when I'm doing a show and I'm leading people down to their seats, because that's mostly what I do.
Yeah.
I really didn't think I could have done that because especially when so many people are coming to like my side. There's the left orchestra and then there's the right orchestra, and there's like so many people, like it was like a rush, and they're flashing the lights and they're coming in. But now I have this instillness of confidence, you know, just like just take every moment as it comes. You know, if I do have moments of like anxiety, you know, here and there.
Sure.
And if there are any moments of anxiety, I just know I've just take a breather or just, you know,
What is your secret of success? Because I think everyone feels socially awkward from time to time. What do you do? You say the deep breath, or what do you envision people naked and then feel it's not that big? That's what they say for public speaking, you know, if you're afraid. It's a weird thing. But what are your secrets? What are your advice?
Well, just be as positive as you possibly can be. Try not to think negative, and just when you meet people, try and find the common ground. whenever you meet like a new person who you've never met, try and find something that you feel like a connection with. You could like movies like they can. You could like music like they can, or this or that. Just a little small spark. There's so many people who have so many differences, and one thing can make a whole world of difference. And you could be friends with. It's very simplistic, and it's definitely helped me, benefited me in the long run.
Wow. Now I found it fascinating. Well, first of all, in your book, it's the book, and it really tells a story about the blonde-haired angel, and talking about how you moved down to Florida, mm-hmm. and you felt very isolated, and yet did you meet her originally in a library?
No, I actually changed it.
Took a little poetic license here with this book.
I did.
There you go. Go ahead.
So the reason
library sounds more erudite and scholarly.
Yes,
there I was at the mall having a Slurpee. That's not the image. I get what you're doing.
Exactly. Okay. Yeah. So I changed it around the book because if I were to because it has a lot.
So there I was reading Shakespeare in the library, and the angel appeared.
Exactly.
Instead of gummy bears at the movies. But
right. Right. Exactly. So when I met, it was after work at the AMC movie theater in real life that when I met her, and it was after I had a little bit of, it was a hard day because you're dealing with so many people, coming in and out. So if I were to write my book and describe here, after a long stressful day at the AMC movie theater, I went down to my local food court. I saw the blonde haired. So that's why I might change it around just a little bit, just a tweak.
It's so funny because I read your book and it's like theater of the mind, and you're going through, and I'm in a library. I'm envisioning Alistair Cook with a fire and a leather chair and leather bound books in there. They walk in, but that's okay. You're the writer. You can write whatever you want. It's mm-hmm. good. But she really took an interest in you. Now she's a pastor's wife.
She was. She's my pastor's wife down in Vero Beach. Their church is First Church of God down in Vero, and they have a wonderful congregation. They're in the middle of the 2020 mission, which they're hoping to expand. It's kind of like the church I have now that I go to here in Connecticut called Faith. And I feel like
Faith up in Brookfield or Milford?
Yeah, up in New Milford, yeah.
New Milford, sure. I drive by there all the time.
So they're hoping to continue to expand their services and reach people, even more people than they already do. And it's a wonderful church, there'll always be family to me. And I actually, with their staff, baptized me just before I left to come back to Connecticut.
Is that right? Well, that's fantastic. Now, it's interesting because on every chapter, you bring a Bible verse into it, like mm-hmm. this chapter when you met this person and you found that it was a wonderful thing, and she gave you a big hug, and mm-hmm. and it says all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. That's Colossians 3:14. And then you talked about not sure what God wants you to do or what was going to happen, mm-hmm. and there's a verse, Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding, and all your ways submit to him, and he will make your paths straight.
Amen. It's a very deeply, my faith has definitely helped me so much, and I read one Bible verse every night before I go to bed, and mm-hmm. I always say the Our Father when I wake up, and it's both autism and faith combined into one beautiful story, and I'm just praying that the story will impact somebody positively like Renee has for me.
Wow, that's neat. I mean, you are an absolute inspiration.
Well, and, thank you, I appreciate
as
it.
As a Christian myself, I have the same situation. When you're not sure what to do, and then you find this verse in the Bible, and you can really hold on to it. Like, trust in the Lord, and he'll make your paths straight. Don't be anxious about tomorrow. Each day has its own worries of itself. There was a long passage. Let me see if I can find it that you quoted. Yeah, here it is.
Featuring one of my favorite which is the cover of the book, which is just the most beautifully done.
This one here?
Yeah.
This is one of the, and by the way, there was another illustrator that put together all these illustrations in the book. But what significance about this? You'll probably see it up on the monitor.
Well, the reason why I love the illustration is because, looking out into seeing the beauty of things, like the blonde-haired angel with her arm around the lone balance and blah, look on to like the beauty in the flowers in the illustration.
Yeah.
It was a testament. It kind of describes me and Renee's relationship, where she just put her arm around me, gave me an encouraging word, and just said, you know, instead of just focusing like all the negativity about people, why don't you just open your eyes to all the beauty and positivity in people? So it definitely speaks a lot, and my illustrator Cleo just brought that to life in just the most beautiful of ways with that illustration.
Yeah, no, I think it's gorgeous. I think all the illustrations in the book really tell a story, and this is the essence of the story. I know it's not an illustration; it's a photograph, but it's just you and Rennie and the way that she was a real lifeline for you. I guess from a Christian perspective, you know, she was God's hand and feet in that situation.
She was.
You know, the Bible talks about how we're supposed to be salt and light. We're supposed to, you know, live out our lives in front of people, to love them, to meet them. You know, like Jesus said, I forget the context of it, but the idea was that, you know, when Jesus said, when I was hungry, you didn't feed me. When I was tired, you didn't help me. When I was in prison, you didn't visit me. And Jesus said, when did we see you hungry? We would have fed you. When did we were in prison? You know, and he said, when you did it to the least of my brothers. Mm. And so I guess from a Christian perspective, we're called to be like Renee, to, if you see someone, reach out to them in love. Because you could be reaching them, well, you could be God's hands and feet reaching out to those people.
I try and put that into everything that I do today, whether it be my work at the Playhouse, whenever my boss, Allison Stockel, who's just the most amazing.
She's incredible.
She really is. And so whenever,
shout out to Allison Stockel.
And if I'm doing a show and I see her like dealing with something, or I feel like she's having like a stressful moment, I'll like send her a text saying you're doing good. You're doing okay. Because I try and be as uplifted as I possibly can to all the people that I know. It's because we can all use it.
Absolutely, absolutely. Alex, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you, Marty.
I really appreciate that. Could you sign my book for me, by the way?
I'd be honored to.
Yeah, just a little signature, maybe right there.
Absolutely.
You know, that would be great.
Anything specific you want me to write?
Marty, you're a great guy. Thanks for having me. No, I'm kidding.
There you go.
Just whatever you want to appreciate. I got an autographed copy from the author, and it's really a great book. Where can people pick up the book?
The book is available as of now just on Amazon.com via paperback or Kindle, but I'm hoping to put it into bookstores just as soon as possible.
All right. And it's a great book. It's a book for all ages. You could, you know, grade school children would get a lot out of it. So buy it by the dozen. Although this is not commercial television, so we're just talking in cultural terms. You know what I'm saying.
It's all about getting it into anybody's hands, the bucket.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mike.
Absolutely great to hear your story, and it was great to have that little reunion, too, with Rennie.
That was great. Okay. That was the highlight of my whole week. It really was.
All right. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
And I'll see you around Ridgefield, too. I'll be coming in to watch some aging rock and roll band at the Ridgefield Playhouse.
I look forward to seeing you soon.
And I want you to introduce me to that Grodin guy, but that's a whole other TV show.
Yes.
All right, thanks so much. Okay, our next guest. Now, this is really going to be exciting because we could have a love match tonight with some absolutely gorgeous cats that are looking for a home. And the next two ladies, Jill and Danielle, Jill Olejniczak and Danielle Van Doren. Danielle is the president of the Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary. And these ladies are doing the Lord's work when it comes to all things cats. And they have, if you're lonely and you need a little companionship, I see the stickers on cars. They said, who adopted who? It should be who adopted whom, but I'm not going to split hairs, but who adopted who? And when you adopt a cat or you adopt a dog, you wonder who is rescuing whom in that situation. Because the kittens that they have at the Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary are absolutely just heartwarming. They're fully taken care of as far as shots and everything like that, and they are looking for a home. And if you're available, you got to get in touch with these ladies. But Jill, I want to thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. And Danielle, thank you.
You.
And what should people know about the Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary?
Well, we are a foster-based rescue program. Mm-hmm. All of our kittens and cats live in foster homes. Most of our cats and kittens are not owner surrendered. They're homeless. So we take them in off the streets. We cover all of Connecticut. And we will go around and we will pick up kittens, orphan kittens, pregnant moms who are going to have babies, moms who have just had babies, and we pick them up and we bring them into our foster homes.
Wow. And we were talking about this before. There's a line between feral cats,
feral,
feral cats, and cats that can be domesticated.
Yes.
And you were giving me some good advice on that. What's the cutoff and what's the best way to handle that?
We find we have better success with feral kittens because they are more easily socialized and they will acclimate to living in a home with a family. As far as feral adult cats, it's much harder.
So
they want to be outside. They're wild and they don't know what people are about and they just want to be outdoors. So it's actually better for them if we can do our trap neuter release program.
So
it's,
trap,
yep.
Then you neuter them and
yep.
Then you release them. And by the way, the kittens that you give out are neutered? Is that's
yes.
Like the you got to do that.
Yes.
Okay.
Absolutely. We are all about population control because there is far too many unwanted animals out there already. And so every kitten or cat that comes through our shelter or through our sanctuary is spayed or neutered for the fact that we don't want any more babies.
Okay, so I mean, it's a weird sort of dichotomy because you're rescuing kittens, yet the overarching concept is there's probably too many cats and dogs. There just
yes,
are.
Too many.
Are. So step one, everyone needs to be neutered.
Yes, because... Okay.
Whether it's a cat or a dog.
Dog, because of the fact that right now there are so many sitting in shelters that are euthanized every day, mm-hmm. and we are a no-kill shelter, so unless it would be a medical reason that the animal would need to be put down,
right.
we don't euthanize just because we're looking for room, which is what a lot of shelters in municipal areas have to do. For example, Bridgeport is a euthanized center. They will euthanize if need be, just to make room if there's too many in there.
Yeah.
So we are trying to cut down on the population, and that's really our goal, is to try to cut down so that we don't have to have so many babies born, you know, because it can get overwhelming. At any given time in our foster homes, we can have up to 65 kittens at a time during the spring.
Why? At the sanctuary?
Yep. Well, we are all foster-based, so these 65 kittens are spread among all my foster homes, all of our foster homes.
Okay, so they're all in individual homes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
How many kittens would you have in one home?
I've had up to 12 in one home, depending on the size of the litter, and if mama took on more babies than she had, because if there's orphans, we like to try to put them with a mom if possible, so that they get some of the good milk and the good behavioral habits that mom teaches them.
And how many of these homes do you have?
We have about 12 foster homes right now.
And you really, really like these people because they're looking
after
these seems like they're doing
the
Lord's work.
We have the best foster homes ever.
Are they able to, you know, no separation anxiety when you finally find a home for these
people?
Like, here you go.
We do have some what we call foster fails.
Foster fails.
It doesn't mean that
okay.
they are failures. It means that they fell in love with their foster cat and they had to keep him.
Oh, okay.
So that's probably one, and I'd say in every foster home has at least one that they were fostering and said, no, this is ours. We're keeping this one.
Okay, so now, do you have too many kittens and not enough places for them, or do you have people waiting in line for kittens and can't wait to get them, or have you got it pretty squared away?
We always need homes for kittens and older cats, especially right now. We have moms from last spring and summer who gave birth, and we need to find those moms' homes also. So we're looking for people who won't mind a year or two old cat.
How old are these cats?
These guys are about 4 months old.
Okay.
The one you have is Sun. And Sun was is a girl, which is weird because normally orange tabbies are males. Sun was part of a litter that unfortunately her litter mates didn't make it.
So she's like the lone survivor?
She was a lone survivor.
Wow.
And so she was nursed to health, and she is a great cat. She really just wants to be in your lap and wants to be loved, and she will crawl up your leg if given half the chance to get your attention. So she's a really great, 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 great cat.
I wonder if my wife's watching. Look what I brought home. It'll be great. Okay, and then what's this cat?
This is Luna. Luna. Luna actually came to us from the streets of Torrington. The streets of Torrington.
Sounds like a Bruce Springsteen song.
She was palling.
From the main streets of Torrington.
She was palling around with what we think was her dad, and this cute couple called us up and said, we don't know what to do with them, and they were kind enough to keep Dad once we got him neutered and taken care of.
Okay.
And so Luna's been in our care ever since.
And so how old is this cat?
She's 4 months old.
4 months, okay.
Yeah.
And she's looking for a home.
They're both she's. Mm. They're both looking for a home.
Right. Well,
come on,
I don't know.
Luna.
If anyone wants to call in right now, 438-2003, we can find homes for them right now. But tell me a little bit, you said you're sort of a different from a rescue mission. Now, when you think of a rescue, like a dog rescue mission, you go down to the kennel, they're all there, they're in cages, and you pick one up and you go home. What's your situation?
So we do out events at Tractor Supply in New Milford, mainly is where we're at during the winter months. We'll be at the farmers market during the summer months in New Milford. But we go to different places to get people to adopt our cats and kittens. We have them in big playpens, okay, so that they can people can interact with them. And then you fill out an application. And provided that your vet check comes back okay and that there's no glaring issues, then you're free to adopt the cat that you choose.
And over the course of a year, in a good year, how many cats will you find placements for?
We had 144 kittens last year and 37 adults.
Wow.
Yeah.
Is that like a high water mark? Or?
That actually was lower than our year before, but our situation changed. We went from actually having a building to being foster only.
Okay.
So that is still relatively good considering we are a different, you know, we had a big change in our rescue this last year.
What happened there? What happened in the building? Or do you and I want to talk about
it? Oh, no. The woman who was loaning us the building actually sold it and moved to West Virginia.
So are you looking for a new kind of situation, or you kind of like it this way?
We love foster homes because we find that they're so much more well-adjusted.
Yeah, the cats themselves.
They're
getting acclimated to humans.
They know what a couch is. They know what a bed is. They know, you know, you tell them not to get on the counters. So when you get these cats, they're not used to living in a cage.
Okay.
They're not living in a cage in a foster home.
Yeah.
They're living in and amongst the humans and other animals and dogs and children. So we kind of call them bulletproof.
Right.
It's
okay.
Kind of our joke is that they're bulletproof because we want them to be around children. We want them to be around adults and dogs and other cats.
Yeah.
So that they get used to all the possible situations that they could go into.
Wow. Yeah, it's interesting because sometimes the dog from the rescue pound, sometimes they don't ever adjust. I mean,
right.
The owners will tell you, well, you know, he was really neglected in a drug den and, you know, somewhere.
Yeah.
And you hear terrible stories. But even with all the love and affection and everything like that, you know that dog is, you know, can be sort of an issue.
Yes.
Kind of the same thing with cats?
Absolutely. Cats that are kept in cages for too long of a time can become cage aggressive, can become very shy,
yeah,
can become very aloof. And because if they're not getting that attention,
yeah,
that people give them, then they become disconnected.
Yeah.
And so the nice thing is she's sitting here purring in my arms,
yeah,
because she's used to being played with, and she's got brothers and sisters she plays with at the house, and you know she sits on the bed and she sleeps with us, so she gets to know all the things that are good in life, for a cat.
Yeah, and you're not just fighting for, you know. And we're talking about that with feral cats too. I have an office down in Portchester. There are feral cats around, and you have like you'll see a little kitten. And your heart goes out to it. It's like, oh, poor little kitty. You know, and it's like, Well, I don't think she wants to be held or taken in or given a bowl of milk or anything. That cat is pretty much on its own. But they seem very happy.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And they usually have a little den tucked in, yep. You know, somewhere in the back of a garage or somewhere, and they seem to, you know, make it pretty well.
Yeah.
All right, tell me a little bit. Okay, we talked about the foster program. Did you're different from other? What is this neonatal program with kittens?
So where our niche is in amongst the rescues is we're known for taking in orphan babies.
Okay.
This past year,
like this one, right?
Like that. This one came to us at about 3 weeks old, so they still need to be bottle fed. They need to be taught how to use the litter box. So if we don't have a nursing mom around, one of our foster parents does that. And so we have foster parents who are up every 2 or 3 hours
bottle feeding
these babies.
Wow.
And the other thing is most of the time when they're really little, they usually are sick. You know, most of the time if they haven't had their mom around, they come in with upper respiratory issues, diarrhea, things that can kill a kitten quite fast, to be quite honest.
Uh-huh.
So one of the things we hang our hats on is our impeccable medical team. Not only do we have...
They're talking about you, you know. They're talking about you.
Not only do we have great people who help us out, our foster moms are really on top of what's going on with them, but we couldn't do it without the help of our veterinarian who is so good to us. And Candlewood Animal Hospital has been there for us from day one. And so they are the veterinarians who do all the hard work on the
cases. Is that the vet where, like, it's the Ark?
No, that's Noah's Ark.
That's another one.
This is up in New Milford. And Dr. Mazel and his staff are absolutely wonderful to us. If I call them up and say, I've got a sick, dying kitten, they tell me to come right down, and they will do everything in their power to save that kitten for us.
Wow. So that's a shout out to, what is it called
again? Candlewood Animal Hospital.
Candlewood Animal Hospital. That's a shout out to them.
Yes.
Fantastic.
Cat people, dog people. Are you one or the other, or can you be both? What are the differences?
I was a cat person. I grew up being a cat person. I think a lot because I only grew up with cats. My parents didn't have a dog, so I had never had a dog. And it wasn't until I got married, my husband got me a dog for our 1 year anniversary.
Okay.
And all of a sudden I said, I'm a dog person too.
Okay.
I'm a cat person at heart. This is my passion. This is Danielle's passion, this rescuing of these cats and kittens. But I'm also a dog person too.
So you're both?
Yes. Oh, I have three cats and three dogs. So.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, what do you think? Do you got to choose and stick with it? Like, Red Sox, Yankees?
I really think it's a matter of what you're looking for. If you're looking for something that's going to go outdoors with you and spend time with you outdoors, then you want a dog. If you want something that's going to sit on your lap while you watch TV, you want a cat. You know, I have one dog and I have nine cats, so I'm definitely more on the team cat.
Team cat.
Yeah.
Is it true that dogs are saying, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And cats are saying, do I love you? Do I love you? Is that exactly what's going on?
That is. There's a saying that says that dogs have a family and cats have staff.
Yep.
Yeah.
So
now, what about, I've heard this, and this could be a vicious rumor that's you know, giving a bad impression about cats. But is it true that they spend their life thinking about ways to eat you? Is that true?
There's a book, How to Tell If Your Cat Is Plotting to Kill You.
Yeah, it must have been that book.
Yes,
yeah.
I got that book from my dad. Yes.
It's just because, you know, size wise they can't quite do it, but they're thinking about it.
If they had opposable thumbs and they were a little taller, we'd be in deep trouble.
Yeah.
You know. Because cats spend 18 hours a day sleeping, so we have no idea.
Is that really the statistics?
Yep,
18 hours a day sleeping.
Yep.
And so, I'm sorry, I interrupted. What
So, you know, during that 18 hours, they've got a lot to ponder.
That's right. A lot of dreaming to do.
A lot of dreaming to do about ways to kill us. But mostly, to be honest, they just want to be loved. You know, at the end of the day, they just want to be held and cuddled. And most of them enjoy interaction. And that's one of the things we pride ourselves in, is that our cats are more social than ones that you would find at a shelter because of the fact that we spend so much quality time with them as babies.
Yeah. Now, cat videos online, by far, the most popular videos are cat videos.
Yep.
Now, I remember one, there was like a mean dog that was going to go after this kid on a tricycle
yes,
or something.
And the cat came in.
And saved the kid, scratched the dog as the dog was about to bite him or something. You could tell.
Yes.
You see it unfolding. So cats really are good for a family. They really are good for kids.
They
They're very patient, it seems like, anyways.
Yes.
We've actually adopted a few of our cats to veterans who have PTSD.
Oh, yeah.
And they are amazing comfort for them.
Yeah.
So it really, and we always say that the cats pick their people. And we can tell at adoption events, you know, somebody will come in wanting something specific and they'll walk away with something completely different because they just fall in love. They bond that quickly that it's quite amazing to watch.
Yeah, it is true. Like even like in prisons, you know, they have the prisoners that deal with the animals. Their heart rates are down, their recidivism rates are down, their, you know, violent situations are down, and PTSD, it's a big deal.
Yes.
You know, we've had veterans on the show that have talked about that. We've actually had comfort dogs here.
Yes.
And it really is there's something to it, you know.
There is. There really
is. Pet owners live longer, it seems like. You can have a dirty, rotten, no good day and come home and your dog just wants you to throw the ball and he'll go chase it. Yep. The cat, you know, will come and sit on your lap while you watch Housewives of New Jersey or whatever it is you're watching.
That's why they have the red bandanas on this month. It's February is National Heart Month. And so we teamed up with the American Heart Association and to raise awareness that pets can lower your blood pressure and calm you down. So that's why they're wearing their little red bandanas on TV tonight.
All right. Well, great. Now, these two cats, they're looking for a home.
Yes.
And if people want to get in touch with you, how would they get in touch with you? Or what should they Google? What's a good website? What's a good phone number?
Go ahead.
They can contact us via our website, which is wellsvalleycatsanctuary.org.
Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary. Just Google it. Okay?
Yeah, Google it. Mm-hmm. Find us on Facebook. You can send us a Facebook message. Or you can call us. Our number is 203-305-2543.
203-305-2543. 2543, okay. And I guess you would say that the cats are free, but there's a suggested price or donation or something like that for all the...
All the medical that we do to them. They do come feline leukemia and AIDS tested. They've got their distemper shots, their rabies shot. They've been spayed or neutered. They've been treated for worms and fleas. So we do ask for a $150 adoption fee.
Okay, and you're a
501c3. We're
that's
a nonprofit.
That's what I was looking for. Yeah, nonprofit, 501c3.
Yeah. So it's tax deductible. Uh-huh. So, and you can find your forever friend.
Yeah, yeah. How long do cats live usually?
Anywhere between 15 and 21 years.
15 and 21
I have
years.
A cat, my cat at home, who's going to be turning 18. And you wouldn't know it. She still plays. She's still crazy. So it's really cool.
Well, Danielle and Jill, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
You're doing the Lord's work. I really appreciate this, and I'm glad you came on the show. And again, it's Wells Valley Cat Sanctuary. If you need a friend for life, you want to lower your heart rate, you want to live longer, you want to have fun and have little videos of cute things your cats do, you got to adopt one of these cats. It's the best deal in town. So I want to thank Alex, and I want to thank Timothy Askew, the two authors who were on the show tonight as well. Go out and get their books. They certainly have a story to tell. And we'll see you next week. I'm not sure what we're doing next week, but I'm sure it's going to be really, really good. And for those of you dealing with what happened in Florida, our hearts go out to you, and you do not walk alone. Good night.